BioVerge podcast with real lit. Yeah, we've got Shankar Ramaswamy on this show today. For listeners not familiar with Shankar, who is he?
I am really excited to welcome Shankar to the show today. Shankar is the co-founder, chairman, and CEO of Kriya Therapeutics. He was part of the early foundational team at Roivant Sciences, where he was responsible for helping to identify and evaluate assets across therapeutic areas and launch Roivant's first public subsidiary. He went on to become chief business officer at Axovant Gene Therapies, which was part of the Vant ecosystem. He holds a medical degree from Brown and an undergraduate degree in economics from Harvard. And I'm really excited to talk with Shankar about his experiences at the Vant companies and how that has informed what he's doing today at Kriya. Because Kriya has this really big and bold mission of moving gene therapies from orphan, rare, monogenic diseases to much larger patient populations. And I'm really excited to dive into how they're doing that, what the platform is that they're building, and talk about some of the therapeutic areas and indications that they're going after.
You talked about his experience at the Vants. His last name may be very familiar to people who follow the biotech industry. How do you think having that kind of up-close and frontline view of the creation and growth of these companies might inform what he's doing at Kriya?
Yeah, sure. And so you mentioned it. I mean, Vivek is his brother, who's one of the founder of the Vants. But I think his experience there is going to bring a lot of information and learnings from some of the successes and some of the failures probably in the Vant ecosystem. They were doing a lot of innovative things in terms of the business model and really trying to push the field of gene therapy forward with all the public subsidiaries that they had. And he saw that firsthand, particularly as the CBO of Axovant and leading some of the development and some of the strategic directives there. So I have to imagine that there's probably some scar tissue and a lot of learnings, as well as what successes they had that he can port over to Kriya. But, it's interesting, as I look at the Kriya team, they've pulled in people with expertise across the field of gene therapy at various companies, which to me is really cool because you couldn't have done that probably even 5 years ago. There just weren't that many companies out there. There weren't that many approved products. There weren't that many therapies in the clinic. And now Kriya has the ability to draw on all this expertise and build a team that does have deep expertise. And so I'm excited to hear how that all informs the efforts to build what they call this fully integrated gene therapy engine at Kriya.
Kriya's focused on gene therapies, but thinking about them as having a potential that reaches well beyond rare monogenic diseases. What's the vision?
Yeah, well, that's what I want to talk to Shankar about. What is the vision? But to my understanding, the vision is moving gene therapies from the monogenic rare orphan diseases into much larger patient populations, much more common diseases that affect, large patient populations. And there's a lot of issues with doing that. There are some technical challenges that I want to get Shankar's input and thoughts on. But then there's a lot of issues around needing to bend the cost curve, right? The approved gene therapies, I believe the most recent one that was approved for beta thalassemia had a $2.8 million price tag. So you can't really have a $2.8 million product that has hundreds of thousands of patients or more that are going to be prescribed that therapy. It'll break the healthcare system. So how do you think about trying to bend the cost curve? What are they doing in terms of manufacturing and everything that goes into developing these novel gene therapies? So, they have a couple platform technologies, one around their computational and biology engine, another around manufacturing. So I really want to dig into some of the details there.
Well, if you're all set,
let's do it, Danny. Shankar, thanks for joining us. I am incredibly excited to welcome you to the show today.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
We are going to talk about gene therapy and specifically moving genetic medicines beyond rare diseases to address more common conditions. At Kriya, you are working on improving how novel gene therapies are designed, developed, and manufactured, all with the goal of improving the speed to market while also reducing costs, which is a critical factor we'll get into more here shortly. Mm-hmm. You started your career at Roivant as one of the earliest team members. Later, you became chief business officer at Axovant Gene Therapies. Both were part of the Vants founded by your brother, Vivek. I want to get into what you learned from those experiences momentarily. But before we do, you have a MD from Brown. And I want to ask, what made you decide to go into the biotechnology industry rather than practice medicine?
Yeah, you know, so I mean, just a little bit about my background. I studied economics at Harvard and went to medical school at Brown and really went into medicine with a passion for drug development. I think that it's just exciting to have the opportunity to bring new medicines, new tools into the toolkit of physicians. And that's what we can do as an industry. If it's done well, that's what we're supposed to be doing. And that always appealed to me. And, you know, my experience in medical school and you know, being a part of the medical community has been very grounding as far as giving perspective on what matters to patients, what matters to physicians. But ultimately, you know, it was my kind of career goal and personal mission in life to be in a position to be able to bring new medicines to patients. And, you know, Kriya is certainly an extension of that. So looking forward to that, advancing that mission here at Kriya.
Yeah, let's talk about that here in a minute, but I do want to circle back to your earlier experiences and talk about what you may have learned from your entrepreneurial trials and tribulations at Roivant and Axovant about developing novel gene therapies.
Sure. I mean, it was a phenomenal experience just in being a part of building what was a very successful company. You know, agnostic to industry at all. I think the Roivant story was just such a huge success. And it was exciting to be a part of that and many learnings of as far as how to build a company well. You know, at Roivant, the model was different than what we're doing at Kriya in a lot of ways, where Roivant had really a thesis around how to accelerate drug development full stop and to reduce the time, the cost, the risk associated with development in close partnership with different companies and different organizations to do that in different therapeutic area verticals. And the model there was to set up different subsidiaries that could be, you know, focused on each of those different initiatives. Now, that was a very novel concept in biotech. And to be a part of that foundational team in, you know, being in a position to help bring on the first assets into the portfolio, help to set up what became the Vants structure across multiple different Vants. You know, that was a lot of learnings through that experience, and Roivant has really perfected that over time. You know, what I took away from that was really in the Axovant journey, where I was the chief business officer. We were focused on neuroscience in particular, initially as a small molecule company. So we had a phase three program for Alzheimer's disease that unfortunately didn't work in a phase three study. And that forced us to really think about pivoting the organization to a focus on something else in neuroscience. And that was really my first foray into gene therapy, just studying the magnitude of effect that we saw from products like Zolgensma and Luxturna, these one and done life-changing curative types of therapies. That was really appealing to me as a physician, as a drug developer, as someone who really cared about helping patients. And so we took Axovant in that direction of building a neurology-focused gene therapy company. And I was the chief business officer in assembling that pipeline together with the rest of the leadership team. I think the learnings through that experience were that, you know, while there's a huge opportunity to actually deliver really novel gene therapies that can have a big effect, it's very complex to do that. And it requires, you know, significant infrastructure and scale and depth of experience and team and capital to do that successfully and repeatedly. And that's really what led me to start Kriya as a company that from its foundation could pull together the right pieces to do this, this process of actually delivering gene therapies at scale, to do that systematically and with the right pieces in place to be effective at delivering products for a variety of diseases. So great learnings, great experiences at, you know, Roivant and Axovant, and, you know, incredibly proud of what that company has done. And, you know, it has really shaped my thinking on how we've gone about things at Kriya.
Yeah, now, you know, I followed the whole Vance story very closely over the years, and it was just, I think, really innovative at the time, and a lot of success with those companies, and sort of a novel way of developing therapeutics. So let's move on to Kriya and what you're doing. But before we get into some of the complexities that you referenced before, let's start with the 30,000 foot vantage point of gene therapy, and then we'll sort of whittle our way down to your pipeline and what you're doing specifically. But I think today, and probably rightly so, people still largely think of gene therapies as a treatment for rare or monogenic diseases, but you're looking beyond that. Where do you see the greatest opportunities in the space today?
Well, I think we're at an interesting inflection point in the field of gene therapy. And just to take a step back and look at what makes gene therapy so exciting, so appealing for patients, for physicians, for investors, it really offers the promise of delivering a one-time treatment that could durably, potentially permanently improve the life of that patient, potentially even cure them of their disease. There are very few types of medicines in the history of medicine that can even claim to do anything close to that. So that's a tantalizing possibility. And we've seen that play out now a couple of times in a few different rare diseases where patients who previously had no treatment options are now living much better, if not close to normal lives. That's been true in spinal muscular atrophy with Zolgensma, with RPE65 related blindness with Luxturna, soon to be with patients with hemophilia B with Hemgenix, which is recently approved. So that's the possibility that makes gene therapy so exciting. It's what drew me to this space. Now, if you look at what that technology could apply to in principle, there's no reason to think about gene therapy as only relegated to ultra-rare diseases where you can charge a multi-million dollar price. If you had the right ingredients to drive down cost, to be able to run large development packages as you would with other therapeutic modalities like small molecules or antibodies, if you could do all of those things and actually manufacture these products at scale, in principle, that technology should work for a much broader universe of diseases. At the end of the day, with the gene therapy, what you're doing is providing the actual genetic material to drive a protein expression within the body itself. So you're converting the cells in the body to be their own therapeutic biofactory to produce these proteins that treat disease. So that's the fundamental concept. And if you apply that more broadly, it does extend beyond rare diseases, beyond monogenic diseases, to polygenic and non-genetic diseases. So that's the ultimate opportunity. That's why we started Kriya, to really make gene therapy a part of mainstream medicine, to make gene therapy for the masses. And what we took note of is what you actually needed to build as a machine to be able to deliver these types of products for that ultimate promise of actually delivering gene therapies, driving continuous protein expression for these very large market opportunities.
And I want to jump into some of that machinery here in a second, but I couldn't agree more. I mean, when I was at the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine, we were funding a gene therapy program targeting children born with severe combined immunodeficiency or SCID, and I had the opportunity to meet a little girl who was enrolled in the clinical trial, and she was cured of SCID. And she lived a normal life and went to school and had a normal life expectancy in it. And it really is along the lines of what you're saying. I mean, it was really treating a previously incurable disease. And it was just really incredible to see her firsthand and see her how much that changed her life and the life of her family. So,
I mean, it really is just to add on that. I think this is why I went into medicine, to be able to help patients. And there's really no larger magnitude of help that you can deliver a patient if you can cure them of their disease. I think that is, to even be able to speak about cures or these types of transformative effects. I mean, we're living in just such a golden era of medicine, and we should be thankful for that. But we also need to think about what can be done to industrialize that, to take it out of the academic realm in a one patient at a time realm to an industrial realm at a hundreds or thousands, millions of patients at a time realm. And I think that's what we're going to see over the next two decades. I started the company with one of my co-founders is Dr. Fraser Wright, who's a professor at Stanford. He was a co-founder of Spark Therapeutics. He was their CTO. He's been a pioneer in the space. And he often talks about that experience of seeing those first few patients cured with Luxturna, which he was heavily involved in developing. It is such a memorable experience for anyone who's been involved with any part of the development process, but it's also a bit sobering that as a field, we're still sitting at only 3 approved AAV products in the US after this many years, and only for very rare patients. So something needs to be done. And that's really why we started Kriya, to help unlock that potential to take gene therapy to a totally different dimension.
Yeah. So Shankar, let's talk about that for a minute. Yeah. What do you see as some of the limitations of gene therapy today? How is Kriya going about trying to address and overcome some of those limitations?
Yeah, so there's a few limitations. I think first and foremost is manufacturing. So this is the most expensive medicine in the history of medicine. You know, you have $3 million plus products, which is unheard of historically in medicine. But part of the reason you have that is because this is probably the most complex, or one of the most complex modalities to manufacture in the history of medicine. There's so many different pieces of the manufacturing process that need to be put together. It's really daunting. And so that's a big challenge, where the cost per dose of even producing the material is just so astronomically high. So that's one major limitation. I think the second, from a sort of corporate standpoint, is access to capital. This is a really intensive, capital-intensive area of drug development. It does require significant investment in infrastructure, in talent, running very large-scale experiments. I view gene therapy development as sort of the inverse of small molecule development. And what I mean by that is kind of an 80-20 rule. To get into the clinic is 20% of the effort with a small molecule, and then you go through phase 1 trials in healthy volunteers, and you have a very challenging road ahead in clinical development because the effect sizes are smaller. The opposite is true in gene therapy, where it's an 80-20 rule. 80% of the challenge is actually getting the product into the clinic itself, because you got to do the vector design, you have to do the analytical method development, the manufacturing. There's just so much to do. But once you get into the clinic, you start right away in patients rather than healthy volunteers, and you have very high degrees of confidence in the translation of that work into clinical success. So that's the sort of inversion of 80-20. And that's why it takes so much capital to actually upfront be able to advance these products into the clinic, as opposed to more conventional drug development, where you can unlock that capital over time as programs mature. So funding is definitely a major constraint in this space. And sort of the third major constraint I'd point to is just expertise, which has contributed to, you know, candidly, subpar execution relative to original expectations. And this is still a young field, all things considered. We're still in the early innings of what gene therapy can do. There aren't infinite pools of talent, and probably not enough talent to sustain the number of companies that exist today. And so, you know, that is a critical reagent to success, is having the right expertise in place and access to talent that knows what it's doing, that it's been through ups and downs in gene therapy. We're sort of at an inflection point in that regard, because we've had some successes and a number of failures that we can learn from. So then you put all of that together, you know, what implications does that have for someone like me, who's starting a gene therapy company, who's built one, to address those challenges and take gene therapy somewhere no one has gone before? And, you know, I think the way that we thought about it was set up the engine solving for those critical issues from the very beginning, and start with that before even thinking about a pipeline. So from the very beginning, we started with our own in-house manufacturing facility that we secured right around the time of our Series A. So this was super early on. And this was a large-scale facility that we renovated to be GMP ready for gene therapy production. It was in use for a different modality. We had set this up in Research Triangle Park in North Carolina with a lot of industry veterans running that facility. So that was point number one. Point number two was we secured a large amount of capital. We knew that this is going to take a lot of money to do this the right way. We've raised about $460 million over the last 3 years to be able to actually invest in what needs to be done and withstand some of the body blows that you're inevitably going to experience in advancing a gene therapy product. And the third was consolidating some of the top talent in the field. We recruited heavily based on personal relationships from companies like Spark, AveXis, Bluebird, Biogen, Pfizer, people who have been in gene therapy for years, who see the promise of gene therapy to go more broad and really have affinity for Kriya's mission. So that was the first part of actually assembling the engine to cure some of the core operational technical challenges of this field. And then we layered into that engine a pipeline that we felt, you know, we could actually, you know, mature using that engine to deliver products for patients.
So Shankar, there's a lot to dive into there. Just one comment, maybe something that I noticed that really jumped out at me. You mentioned the team, and it's really amazing to me that you really have assembled a team that has a diverse set of experiences at several different gene therapy companies, which to me is really amazing that that is now possible. That probably wasn't possible five plus years ago to draw on that those various expertise, because there weren't that many companies that had approved products or therapies in the clinic. And so it's really nice to see that you could draw on that pool of expertise. So just
totally. I mean, I would say that it would have been challenging to start a company like Kriya 5 to 7 years ago, because you had to have those battle scars worn by people who have been through it. They've been through, you know, registrational processes. They've been through failures of, you know, preclinical, clinical failures. So there's a learning that comes from that and battle scars that are worn that we can now actually build upon a critical mass of experience in a way that some of the early pioneering companies couldn't. You know, they're shooting completely in the dark, flying blind. And, you know, huge credit to those pioneers for being able to deliver successful products like Luxturna and Zolgensma, because it was incredibly challenging to do that. Now the bar is much higher that, okay, now we know what we're doing more or less in this space. What can we actually do with the technology? And when we recruited Kriya, you know, we used very few recruiters as part of our recruiting process. These are, you know, industry veterans that we know personally, or people that we know can get the job done based on their set of experiences. And we systematically recruited those individuals to really, you know, the mission that we have, which resonated with them, which is let's build on all of these years of experience, all of these successes and failures, and perfect the engine that could deliver products for a much broader set of diseases.
Yeah, and maybe we could just follow that line of thinking one step further and talk about the platform now, because you've developed what you call an integrated model. Can you explain what you mean by this integrated model and how that works in practice?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, I would say our machine, if you will, at Kriya is composed of three foundational pillars. So one of those is manufacturing. So we control our own manufacturing. That is not just the GMP supply, but also all of the things earlier in development that tie into construct design and candidate selection. So manufacturability assessments, packaging efficiency, purity of product, the analytical methods, the release methods for those products, all of that is deeply embedded in the manufacturing category and pillar of the company. So that's one. The second is a research biology pillar. And this, again, is based in North Carolina in Research Triangle Park, right side by side with our manufacturing facility. And there we have our own in-house capabilities for, you know, vector design, immunology, bioanalytical development, genomics, next-gen sequencing. All of that is integrated and tightly coordinated with our manufacturing. And the third core pillar is computational biology. So we have a team focused on genomics, large data set generation and analysis, machine learning, programming, algorithmically enhanced vector engineering. So basically thinking about algorithms that can identify particular problematic elements of different products that contribute to poor expression, poor manufacturability, high immunogenicity, and help engineer these products to avoid those challenges using a computational approach. So having those three pillars in one company allows us to make iterative improvements of each of our products and embed learnings from product A to product B through Z and in completely orthogonal therapeutic areas. So that's where the scale of our company just allows us to utilize that engine more effectively and effectively spread that across different products. So that's just a different approach than, you know, frankly, a not as well capitalized or more academic type of company or effort, where you might have one of those pieces, but you're reliant on an external party for manufacturing. You're reliant on an external party for, you know, bioanalytical development. And the consequence of that is that you don't have the flywheel effect of learnings in real time that contribute to iterative improvements in the product. So, you know, if you are sending a vector out to be manufactured by a CDMO, they'll make it exactly the way you want it for one particular version of that construct. Let's say it doesn't package very well, or it's not a very pure product, you're going to be left scratching your head as to why that was the case. Was it a process issue? Was it an analytical issue? Was it a molecular issue with the construct? Whereas in our case, we can actually look at that flywheel in real time and say, hey, we're seeing a pattern of this particular sequence, let's say, contributing to this poor, you know, titer. And so let's correct that issue at the molecular fundamental issue, fundamental level. So I think those are the types of learnings that we can benefit from by having this fully integrated machine. And I think about, you know, where the solution may lie, whether it's a manufacturing, a computational, or research solution.
Yeah, that's really fascinating, because I know early on in many companies' life cycles, they have to make the decision whether they want to build out manufacturing capabilities yeah. in-house or outsource. And it always is a big question early on. It sounds like that was never really a big question that you wrestled with. It sounds like it was always something that you knew needed to be built in-house so you could have full control over all of these different processes. And as yeah. you mentioned, could learn and iterate from, which I think is really powerful.
Yeah, I think it was never a question for us, because we've lived this space, a lot of us, in different ways. You know, I come from more of the business and medical background. Fraser, my co-founder, was the CTO of Spark. Britt Petty, who's leads our manufacturing, he was the chief technical officer at AveXis. Like, we've seen this and lived it, so we know what's needed to do this right. And I don't think most gene therapy companies would dispute that. The challenge is really the capital and the team that's required to do that. So it's easier said than done. I mean, I've lived this last few years building the company. It is challenging to raise that amount of capital to really recruit that type of team. But if you do that, I firmly believe, and I don't think anyone would contest this, that's the right way to do it. And it just unlocks opportunities. And, you know, just to step back on your question, manufacturing, I think that we have to be a little bit more specific about thinking about what manufacturing is. And I sort of split it in two categories. So there's a sharp dichotomy between these. One of these is commercial late phase manufacturing. So if you think about phase three commercial manufacturing, you know, that requires large capacity. It requires large scale, good sort of quality. It's more industrial at that phase. If you think about early phase manufacturing, phase one, two, preclinical manufacturing assessments early on, that's really where the scientific innovation happens, because there's a direct feedback loop to the molecular design of the products, which have an impact on the process performance and process that you will actually use for that particular product. Those are two very different types of manufacturing activities. And, you know, we've made this decision for sure to build out the earlier phase, you know, to support products through that phase one, two manufacturing. We have the opportunity to build the phase three commercial, and we'll evaluate whether that makes sense at the relevant time. But, you know, you can also outsource some of that, and it's not as, let's say, sophisticated from a technical standpoint. The way I think about it is sort of thinking about the recipe. You know, you have your world expert chef who's coming up with a very precise way to make that particular dish. That's, you know, one of a kind. You know, there's only a handful of those types of chefs in the world. We're fortunate to have some of them at our company. And then you have your commercial kitchen that can just crank it out. And we may build our own commercial kitchen. We may expand our facility to be a commercial kitchen, or we may find another commercial kitchen. That's a different part of the process that's, frankly, easier solved.
Yeah, and I like thinking about it broken down into those two discrete parts. And, you know, as is often said in the cell and gene therapy world, the process is the product. And so it's really mm-hmm. important to call yeah. that early
phase. Really is. I mean, I would venture to guess a lot of the failures that we've seen in the clinic or safety and toxicity issues, there is some element of manufacturing, you know, performance that is a contributor to some of those effects. I'm sure this data will come out over years when we have large data sets and we can look at this, but that is a hypothesis that we have, that the purity of the product, the way these are manufactured, the heterogeneity of that product, even those things contributing to the quote unquote dose of the product, right? Those are impacting the immunological profile of these products, the durability, and ultimately the efficacy. So, you know, there is a direct tie-in across, you know, manufacturing that doesn't allow you to segregate that from the rest of development.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And we could probably spend the rest of the episode talking about manufacturing, but I do want to move on. And I want to talk about your pipeline, mm-hmm. which you don't advertise on your website, but you have been building a gene therapy pipeline, at least in part through acquisitions. Can you talk a little about the strategic rationale behind these acquisitions and what made these particular acquisitions and indications ones that you wanted to go after?
Yeah, absolutely. And you're right, we haven't disclosed a lot on the company website, and that'll change over time. You know, we're a private company, and one of the benefits of being a private company is you can focus on the work at hand and not have to, you know, give updates every time that people expect them. So we'll look forward to sharing more in the pipeline. I think to tell you a little bit about our pipeline, we focused on really three core therapeutic areas: metabolic diseases, neurology, and ophthalmology. And I'll talk about some of the specific diseases we're going after, but the common thread across these different areas and diseases, you know, we're focused on obviously one and done approaches. So with gene therapy, one of the benefits is that you have the opportunity for a one-time delivery that can drive, you know, a lifetime or several years of benefit. And we are looking to target diseases where that benefit would be of significant impact to patients. So that's one key parameter. The second is where the biology is well understood. As a company, we're focused on really taking technology risk. Can we engineer the gene therapy to do what we want it to do in terms of driving durable protein expression, as opposed to taking on biological risk, where we're trying to validate a new target that may not have prior validation? So we're focused on validated biology and driving better engineering of the therapeutic. All of our approaches are focally delivered. So this is targeting specific tissues where we want the actual gene therapy to be transducing cells and expressing protein. So we deliver directly to those tissues, whether it's direct injection into the eye, into the muscle, into, you know, the trigeminal ganglion, as you'll hear about, with the goal of making sure that our product gets where it's supposed to get and minimizing the toxicities from off-target types of effects. That also has the benefit of reducing the total dose that the patient's exposed to. So that's a core parameter. And then lastly, we're looking at diseases where there's opportunity for significant clinical benefit to the patient. So transformative types of effects, not incremental, and where there's large commercial opportunities, where there's a validated market for these types of products. And so, as I mentioned, that led us to really focus on three core therapeutic areas, the pipeline being built through a combination of internal R&D, company acquisitions, licensing, partnerships with academic groups, all of those leveraging the same engine that I described before. In metabolic disease, the lead program is for diabetes, both type 1 and insulin-dependent type 2 diabetes. And this is a program that originated from one of the leading academic groups in Spain. Fatima Bosch is the lab. She's one of the pioneers in gene therapy, but she and her group had done a phenomenal job of building a program that had shown really robust efficacy across multiple different animal models, including in diabetic dogs, for 8 years. So they actually generated data showing 8 years of complete disease correction and insulin independence in diabetic dogs. That is now a program that we're advancing with some of the things that needed to be done to, you know, turn that from an academic package into an actual industry package, and scale up manufacturing, optimize the vector, and actually take that into the clinic. So that's the work that's ongoing there. In neurology, this pipeline came through the acquisition of a company called Redpin Therapeutics, which is one of the pioneering chemogenetics companies using a small molecule, in their case, Chantix, which is for smoking cessation, so a super safe product that's been in millions of healthy adults, to basically regulate the activity of an expressed engineered ion channel that can reduce hyperexcitation in overactive neurons in focal epilepsy and trigeminal neuralgia. So that's the program there that has application even far beyond those two diseases. And then lastly, in ophthalmology, we have a pipeline focused on really immune modulators for highly prevalent ophthalmic diseases, and the lead program there being for geographic atrophy, which is a space where hopefully we'll see some small molecules actually get approved in the next, coming months. But we have the opportunity with the one and done gene therapy to really deliver a much larger effect, we think, in that particular disease. And that's a program that came through a collaboration with the University of South Carolina and a couple other academic groups. So all in all, you know, it's a vast pipeline. We have over a dozen programs in the portfolio, and you know, we're continuing to advance these through the various stages of preclinical development with an eye to bringing these all into the clinic and ultimately to commercialization. That's something that we intend to do ourselves.
And Shankar, all of the programs that you just referenced, as far as I'm aware, are built around adeno-associated viral vectors or AAVs.
That's right.
Why the focus on AAVs specifically?
Well, we think, I mean, AAV is a very validated delivery vehicle. So there's many different ways to deliver a gene therapy, and there are unique challenges to each of them. I think one of the things that we view AAV as being validated based on the number of patients who have been treated with it, the durability that's been established, the manufacturability that has been established. So our platform is really built to deliver these AAV therapies very quickly and consistently. And, you know, we recognize some of the limitations of AAV. Ultra high dose systemic AAV does pose some challenges from an immunological perspective. And it can be difficult to manufacture. That's why we've invested in what we have. So there are some limited challenges. There are certain tissues where it could be very difficult to actually transduce. And you need novel capsids and novel work to do that. We've picked a set of targets where, you know, we can actually give the AAV at a low to modest dose, focally administered, so there's minimal contribution to systemic toxicities, and that we are confident can be manufactured at scale based on the doses that we're advancing. And that means that we can focus on some of the challenges on the actual protein itself. You know, we can actually put most of our innovative effort on expressing these complex proteins that go after these multifactorial diseases on validated pathways. And over time, you know, we will continue to evaluate where AAV could be the right delivery vehicle, or in the future, if we want to go after a disease where a different delivery vehicle would be better, we'll certainly consider that as well. But, you know, we think AAV has, you know, wide application, and with the right sort of engine behind it, can actually do a lot.
Yeah, I think that makes total sense. And Shankar, I want to circle back to actually a comment that you made earlier and talk about funding. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned before you raised about $400 million in total. Your last round was a $270 million Series C led by Patient Square Capital. Mm-hmm. First, I want to just talk about and ask you about your ability to absorb and put all that capital to work. Mm-hmm. And what that enables, does that enable you to do more in parallel with the same programs, fund more programs, make more acquisitions? Or how do you generally think about deploying that amount of capital?
Yeah, I mean, so we've raised a little north of $460 million in the last 3 years. You know, we raised about $87 in the Series A, $100 in the Series B, and just north of $270 in the Series C. And so, you know, that is a lot of capital for any company to take on, especially one as young as ours. But we felt it was really essential to, A, moving fast. So we wanted to build this company in lightning speed, which we have done. The second was make the right investments in infrastructure with confidence at the beginning. And the third is, you know, we are building ultimately a company that we think can be a pharma-like company. I think you look at companies like Moderna who have done this in mRNA. You know, we think there is room and need for that in gene therapy. And we hope to be that type of company. So the ultimate ambition here is to really deliver an entire portfolio all the way through commercialization for these big market indications. If we're going to do that, it's going to require a lot of capital, which we're prepared to raise and access. And with Patient Square leading the Series C and the Series B, they have been, you know, pretty much an ideal partner to us because their mission is also to build industry-defining dominant companies. And so they've shown that confidence in us. And, you know, we have a great partnership in actually what it will take to build that type of generational company, as well as with the rest of our syndicate who have that as the ultimate vision to, you know, build a company that isn't here just to do a quick flip for a modest step up or, you know, whatever it might be. This is a company that is built to be a generational company. And so, if that's the ultimate end goal, you need to raise a lot of capital to do that, which, you know, I think it's been a nice marriage of both the investors and the company to do that.
Yeah, and I want to dive into that last point for a minute because, you know, your Patient Square just announced that they closed a $3.9 billion fund, which, mm-hmm. to my knowledge, is the largest healthcare-specific PE or VC fund ever. And so just at a very high level, Shankar, how do you think that impacts companies in our ecosystem? Do you think there's going to be more funding that are going to be dedicated to building generation-defining companies as opposed to companies that are built for M&A, for example? How do you think about that at a sort of a high level?
I do think so. I mean, I think it's good for the space, first of all, to have investors like Patient Square who are, you know, patient is in their name, you know, right? They are focused on you know, being there to support companies all the way to the very end. And that very end may be no end, right? So I think that is just great to have that type of dominant investor. You know, what they're building is really going to transform the healthcare and biotech universe. And, you know, then they're a great set of people and a great team that believe in what they're doing. And, you know, that I think for a long time, biotech had been in this sort of kind of flip mode of just putting in just enough to flip it to the next person to hold the bag. And that's not really doesn't track with scientific progress and medical innovation. You need to have patience. You're going to have obstacles and challenges. You're going to burn a lot of money because you need to figure those things out. But the other side of that is you have the opportunity to help a lot of people with products that can work and make a lot of money if you deliver products that work. So I think it requires a different phenotype of investor, which we're starting to see from groups like Patient Square who are transforming that landscape. And I think that's a net positive for patients at the end of the day. Now, you know, what that means as far as the biotech model of the last decade, which is really around, I think, a lot of incremental therapies, a lot of kind of quick exits, you know, I think we'll have to see how that ripples through, and the current market environment is certainly, you know, forcing that to some degree. But I think from a strategic perspective, you know, investors like Patient Square are kind of here to define, you know, healthcare over the next few decades.
Yeah, and I think it's a huge innovation in our ecosystem to have that amount of capital being put to work within our, you know, industry in general. Shankar, I have one burning question that I do want to ask before we wrap up. I want to go back. You mentioned you have a program targeting diabetes, and I want to tie that back to this idea of bending the cost curve. You had mentioned, you know, multi-million-dollar gene therapies that have been approved. You know, those are for monogenic diseases. How much do you think we need to bend the cost curve to be able to afford a gene therapy for a disease like diabetes, for example, so that it doesn't break the bank of the healthcare system?
Yeah, I mean, it's top of mind for me, and it's personal for me, actually. I mean, one thing I'll share is, you know, my grandfather had type 1 diabetes, you know, his whole adult life. And, you know, he was grew up very poor in India, you know, and it was a challenge and a struggle for them in that environment. My mom is actually she's a physician. And one of the things that she did when she first came to the U.S. as a practicing physician, as a resident, was to buy clean needles for her parents to send back home. And that was one of the most meaningful gifts they could give. And, you know, it is the sort of thing that so many people struggle from around the world of all socioeconomic statuses that, you know, we need to do something to address big problems in medicine like that. So that is, I think, something all of us who have some means to address problems of that scale have an obligation to try their best to do that. And with a gene therapy, you have the opportunity to deliver a type of clinical benefit that, you know, we haven't seen historically in that space or in any of these other spaces we're going after. And so that's the potential benefit and impact to patients around the world that could, you know, from a pure clinical perspective, take cost out of the equation, would really live much better lives with therapies like these. So then the question is, what do you need to do to bring down the cost to make those types of therapies affordable and accessible? And there's different factors that we've talked about over this conversation, whether it's manufacturing, development costs, you have it. But if we can solve that issue, just, you know, the magnitude of impact that we can have across society at this type of scale is just really exciting to think about. So I think we have that obligation starting from the patient first, you know, that patient being in many cases for these diseases, it hits close to home for a lot of us. We suffer from these diseases. Loved ones suffer from these diseases. You know, that's the ultimate goal of helping those patients. Stepping back from that, what a gene therapy could do, it would completely change the life of that patient for the better. And then stepping back from that, how do we actually make that gene therapy accessible and affordable to each and every one of those patients? You need to drive down cost in every dimension. And so, you know, that's where I start just working back to why Kriya exists, to be able to deliver those types of curative effects to all patients at lower cost and more consistently. It's kind of a rambling answer to your question, but I do think cost is at the center of a lot of the equation, and I think there's something we can do about it.
Yeah, and Shankar, I love your perspective on this, and it's really, you know, we need to work backwards with the patient in mind, right? And use the patient as sort of the North Star, mm-hmm. the guiding light for all of these developments, whether they're manufacturing or whatever they may be. So,
yeah.
You know, we could probably talk for another 2 or 3 days about these topics. And I'd love to invite you back on the show, you know, once you have some more progress with your pipeline and talk about more about what you're doing. But we better leave it there. So Shankar, I'd like to say a huge thank you for joining me today. And thanks for a really great and wide-ranging discussion.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of fun, and happy to come back anytime.
Well, Neil, what did you think?
I thought that was a fantastic conversation with Shankar. I mean, I love all the topics that we hit on. I mean, we could have spent a couple episodes just on the manufacturing component of what they're doing. But, you know, what really struck a chord with me is you heard Shankar say they've raised, I believe, just north of $460 million. The company's only about 3 years old. And so this idea of having very deep-pocketed VCs behind them, like Patient Square, gives them a huge competitive advantage in building out this fully integrated machine that you heard Shankar describe to really control manufacturing, preclinical development, all those things through the entire process, which gives them the ability to iterate and learn as opposed to outsourcing stuff to a CDMO with the goal of building a generational type company. And to me, that's just so powerful. And you heard Shankar talk a lot about the patient and, you know, working backwards sort of with the patient in mind and how their approach will really ultimately benefit the patient by having control over the entire process from, you know, start to finish.
These have been expensive therapies in part because they're one and done for small patient populations. What does Kriya have to do to reimagine gene therapies?
Well, you heard Shankar talk a lot about manufacturing, and I think he made this great analogy with the 80-20 rule. Right, in the gene and cell therapy world, you know, 80% of the work is done up front before you even get into the clinic, unlike small molecules, which is essentially the reverse of that. But you heard us talk a little bit about this idea of the process is the product. And so for them, they need to really lock in the process and spend a lot of time, a lot of capital to ensure that they have a robust and scalable process with proper QC to be able to characterize the product that they're putting into the clinic at the end of the day. And there's a lot of complexities around that. We barely scratched the surface of some of those, but you know, they have obviously built and are continuing to build some of that infrastructure to enable them to do that. And obviously the goal of doing all of that is at the end of the day to be able to move the cost of these therapies from multi-million dollar therapies for the monogenic diseases to, you know, something hopefully much more affordable that a much larger patient population can access.
There are some other companies out there looking to develop gene therapies that would treat large market conditions by getting the body to produce a therapeutic protein. Company doing this with eye disease, another with joint disease for arthritis. Their focus has been on individual therapies, though, rather than the manufacturing process and building with cost and scale in mind, as Kriya is doing. How do you think that might play to Kriya's advantage?
Well, I think it plays to their advantage in a massive way, right? I mean, they really are building out this entire platform. And as you heard Shankar talk about, I mean, their focus is on AAV. Might not always be that way in the future, but you know, there are certainly some, I would imagine, large economies of scale that they get from their investment in all this infrastructure that will be harvested across their programs. And I think about it in terms of what we were doing at the California Institute for Regenerative Medicine. I mean, when I left, we were funding over 50 different clinical trials, but we also funded a tremendous amount of infrastructure to support those clinical trials, whether that was in our Alpha Stem Cell Clinics network, which were, you know, specific clinical trial sites for the delivery of cell and gene therapies, to your preclinical manufacturing initiatives or whatever it may be. But there's a whole host of infrastructure that needs to support the clinical development. A lot of times companies outsource some of that stuff, but I think by doing it in-house, there's a tremendous amount of learnings that were accrued to Kriya that can be spread across the platform. So the capital that they have raised to build that type of infrastructure, I think, gives them a pretty big competitive advantage.
You did talk about the team, which is made up of people who have been at companies that have brought gene therapies through the pipeline and to the market. What do you think that suggests about where we are with gene therapies today?
Well, to me, that's really exciting because Kriya has been able to draw upon all of this diverse set of experiences at multiple companies that have developed gene therapies, whether they're approved products or they're in clinical trials. And that type of talent pool probably didn't exist even 5 years ago. And so to me, that's really exciting that the field has moved so far, so fast, that Kriya is able to draw upon this diverse talent pool and bring all this talent in-house with all these different sets of experiences. So it's becoming, I don't want to say it's mainstream, but it's becoming much more easy to access the talent, although it's still a challenge, right? This is still a new field. There's still a lot of challenges with developing and manufacturing these. There's not that many approved products yet, right? So, but to me, it is a sign of excitement for the industry.
Well, until next time.
Okay, Danny, thank you.
Thanks for listening. The BioVerge podcast is a product of BioVerge Inc., an investment platform that funds visionary entrepreneurs with the aim of transforming healthcare. BioVerge provides access and enables everyone to invest in highly vetted healthcare startups on the cutting edge of innovation. From family offices and registered investment advisors to accredited and non-accredited individuals. To learn more, go to BioVerge.com. This podcast is produced for BioVerge by the Levine Media Group. Music for this podcast is provided courtesy of the Jonah Levine Collective. All opinions expressed in this podcast by participants are solely their opinions and do not reflect the opinion of BioVerge Inc. or its affiliates. The participants' opinions are based upon information they consider reliable. Neither BioVerge or its affiliates warrants its completeness or accuracy, and it should not be relied on as such. Nothing contained in accompanying this podcast shall be construed as an offer to sell, a solicitation of an offer to buy, or a recommendation to purchase any security by BioVerge, its portfolio companies, or any third party. Past performance is not indicative of future results.